much today with us. I honor God for our moderator, Ellen Newton. I honor God for Mrs. McKenzie, who prayed a hoping prayer. Sister Casey, who did a wonderful rendition of Trust and Obey. I honor God for the ushers, the visitors, my friends, Sister Magdalene and Sister Markey and Mr. Markey and Brother Wilfred Edgecombe, Brother Gabriel's son, and my friend in the back from Eleuthera. We thank you, Sister Morning, for doing such a wonderful job and playing this morning. Thanking God now for the person who moved the camera. I'm sure you're going to be moving plenty this morning, because I'm going to be moving now, right now. So we give God praise for everything that she has done for us.
Yes, yes.
We are glad. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be thoroughly acceptable in thy sight. Lord God, you are my strength and you are my redeemer. This morning I want to talk, as the Spirit has led me, around a very, very important subject. And this subject is grace. It comes from Paul's letter to Titus. And he commands at verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Grace. This morning, I believe I'm right when I say that if it were not for grace, none of us would be here in this place.
Amen.
And we could be here, but our condition would not be what it is now. Grace, we learn in our Bible classes in Sunday school, is God's unmerited favor. And if we use some acrostics, we can say GRACE stands for God's riches at Christ's expense. Grace is the goodness of God on behalf of sinners who humbly acknowledge their own deficiencies and thus their dependence on God's grace for forgiveness and salvation. God resists the proud, but God gives grace to the humble. This morning, God's grace, this unmerited favor, appears to all people. Whether you are in Timbuktu, whether you are in Swaziland, whether you are in the Netherlands, Iceland, or Greenland, wherever you are, you cannot ever escape the grace of God. No soul that has ever come to this earth and has reached the age of reason, can go before the Bema or the throne of God and say, I was never exposed to your grace. For the Bible teaches us that the grace of God appears to all men.
Amen.
But there is another scripture that tells us that the grace of God comes to everyone. Whether they have been exposed to Jehovah, or whether they have been exposed to Him as Yahweh, the Bible teaches us, for God has shown Himself unto them. God has manifested Himself to them. And whatever is to be made known of God is made known through the invisible things that God has created from the world began. They are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Nobody who come to this world will be able to say that I have not been privileged to the grace of God. My friends, this morning, grace, this grace is that which leads a sinner from a life of sin. And there are two categories of people who need grace. Firstly, the sinner. John 3:16 tells us that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. When we are beyond John 3:16, on the back side of John 3:16, we are willful sinners.
Yeah.
Our father is the devil. He is a liar, he is a murderer, he cannot speak the truth. And whatever the devil tells us to do in the back side of John 3:16, we are going to do it. We have no remorse. We have no conscience. We do whatever we feel that we ought to do. But the Bible teaches us that there is a point in time when the grace of God meets us at a crossroad. The grace of God, as we are traveling down this sinful pathway, the grace of God meets us at a crossroad and directs us to Christ, the suffering servant of Israel, who took upon Himself the form of man, the form of a servant, became man. When He found Himself in the likeness of sinful man, He volunteered and submitted Himself to death, so that you and I, we can have a right to the tree of life. For the Bible teaches us that before John 3:16, all have sinned. All have come short of the glory of God. While we were yet sinners, however, Christ died for us. And so we reached to this place where grace and mercy had a meaning. Mercy said, I will give you a chance. Grace said, I will help you on the journey. They hold hands together and begin to walk down the road until they reach the crossroad where they find justice.
Amen.
Justice looked up, but eluded and said, Grace said, I'm giving you a favor. God is saying this morning that if you are on the backside of John 3 and 16, His grace is now coming to you. The Bible says that the Spirit of God, whom God sent to the world, He reproves the world and proves the world that it is unrighteous, that it's sinful, that its very deeds are evil, and there needs to be a reprieve. You need to change. This is what the Holy Spirit does for us. Teaches us that we've got to make a change in our lives. Before John 3 and 16, He tells you that there is blood, there is power, there is offering. Yeah. Somebody has paid the price to release you from the scourge of sin. Yeah. Jesus the Christ, the last offering that God could give, has paid that price. And all you have to do is believe.
Amen.
It came to pass that Paul in Romans. The Bible says that God gave us grace through faith, not of works, lest any man shall boast. It's a free gift. How many of you know it's a free gift? When you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, God gives you a proportion of grace. The proportion of grace that you need is enough to take you from beyond John 3 and 16 to Revelation chapter 21 and 1, when John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. This grace that God gives you is sufficient for all your deficiencies.
Yes.
The grace of God gives you strength and sufficiency to carry you over your deepest and darkest hours.
Yes.
I came here this morning to tell you, and if you are still in the back of John 3 and 16, you have not accepted this gift, this morning must be the day when you lay down your war tools of Satan and put on the armor of God.
Amen.
I will guarantee you today that if you give Jesus a chance in your life, things will be different. The load and the burdens that you carry around, the trials, the misfortunes that you can't seem to adjust to, God will give you the strength by His grace to bear that burden.
Yeah.
The Bible says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation to man, appeareth. It came, appears to every man. And once we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, this grace goes into overdrive. Grace, friends, I ask a question as we nearly made this stop. How often have you looked at yourself and said, oh my Lord, I can't believe this is me again? How often have you reached the stage where the Holy Spirit caused you to take an introspection of yourself and see how far you have wandered away from God? Friends, today, grace, God's grace, this marvelous grace of God will teach us some things.
Yeah.
Firstly, what it will teach us, that we must deny ungodliness. Somebody say godliness. Friends, this morning, there is a growing fad around the world, a fad of fake. Somebody claimed the word of fake news. But last week, as I was praying and seeking the Lord, God showed me an epiphany. In fact, God showed an epiphany to this church. And right in the church lie a serpent. We sat on the serpent, and the serpent got strength from of this faith stuff. God said, I'm looking for a people who will worship me. God said, I'm looking for a people who will serve me in the very beauty of holiness. My friends today, the Bible teaches us that the woman said to Jesus, my forefathers worshiped in this mountain. Jesus said, woman, you do not know who you're worshiping, for worshiping is of the Jews. But I'm going to tell you, woman, God is not requiring us to worship here. Because what God is looking, he is looking for the true worshiper.
Yes.
God is looking for the true worshiper.
Yes.
And God said, if you're going to worship me, you got to worship me in spirit and in truth. Yes. I said, oh my God, God, I feel some faith on me.
Yes.
I said, God, I feel a little faith, some faith on me. God said, you got to get rid of the faith. God said, I'm not going to deal with fake people. God said, I'm not going to show my glory to fake people. If we're going to get God's glory, we have to pay the price. And that pay the price is to deny ungodliness.
Amen.
Hey, hold on now. Wait a minute. Oh, child, I'm only a sinner. Friends, you're a sinner before John 3:16. When you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, according to the Bible, God translates you out of the kingdom of darkness, and God puts you into the kingdom of his dear son, Jesus. You are then saved by his grace. You are redeemed by his blood, and therefore, you are no longer a sinner as practicing sin. The last time I checked, whenever Paul wrote to the church, Paul said, unto the saints at the church in Corinth, to the saints in the church of Rome, to the saints in the church of Ephesus, I give you this morning to tell you, if you can't call yourself a saint, then you are on the backside of John 3:16. You need to come on the forefront of John 3:16 and get down to Ephesians 2, Isaiah 9, for by grace am I saved through faith, and I shall confess with my mouth, and I shall believe with my heart that God hath raised from the dead. Now this morning I want you to examine yourself.
Yes.
You gotta examine yourself to see if you are truly of God. God is looking for devotion. Somebody say devotion.
Devotion.
Go to my people who humble themselves and pray. Humble themselves mean, and we will stop doing it our way. We will stop relying on our own intellectual abilities. We will stop allowing on our own instincts, and we will put our trust fully in God. You need healing, you gotta trust him.
Yes.
You want something done, you gotta trust him. And let me tell you this morning, God may not come to you when you want to him to come. But I can tell you beyond a shadow of a doubt that he's a God who is always on time. Sometimes man's time and God's time, they run contrary to the other.
Yeah.
And because of us seeing ourselves for notoriety, and for men to tap us on the back and say, well done, we believe that we are behind schedule. But I came here this morning to tell you that they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They should run on the wings as eagles. They should run and not get weary. They should walk and they'll not faint. You need to ask the Lord to teach me how to be. This grace, friends, teaches that we must deny all ungodliness, all worldliness, everything that pits itself against God. We have to deny ourselves these things. And let me tell you, friends, God said when we reference him, when we call on him in the sincerity of heart, when he shows up, he's going to show up with power and with authority.
Amen.
I said power and with authority. I leave you with these words. The psalmist was in some kind of dilemma. And the psalmist in Psalms chapter 46 In the psalmist, the psalmist said, "In I cry unto the Lord." I cry. Someone say, "Cry."
Cry.
I cry unto the Lord. I heard me. This poor man cried. What was this man crying about? Could it be that he was caught in the paralysis of sin, caught in the paralysis of whatever the works of the flesh are, 19 or 31 of them, whatever they be, he was caught in the paralysis of this misdemeanor or maybe a felony. But whatever it was, it was so egregious, so painstaking, so hard and harsh upon his soul, and so harsh upon his conscience. The Bible says, he said, "I cried unto the Lord, and he heard me."
Yes.
He heard me. And then grace came in. And he delivered me. This is grace. He delivered me from all of my trials. God delivered me. And we see grace manifested in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. That God is a God of grace in the Old and God is a God of grace in the New Testament.
Amen.
Grace did not start with John 3 and 16. Grace started before John 3 and 16 when Jonah was sent to Nineveh. God said, "Those people that sin and be wicked, I need to do something for them. I need to extend not only grace but mercy to them." Go down to Nineveh, Jonah, and tell those people that they have a God to serve, they have a soul to save, and a God to glorify. Tell those people to repent of their wicked ways.
Yes.
And all of Jonah said, "God, I'm not going down to Nineveh. Because then you preach when I preach, the minute I finish preaching. Something about the character. The Jonah in that being seen as a fault in character. That you say one thing and do another thing." And so Jonah's experience led him to say, "I am not going to do it. I'm going about my own business. I am going to do my own thing." He got on a ship that was bound to Tarshish.
Yes.
And while he was on this ship, bound to Tarshish, a storm arose of exceedingly great proportion and made everybody unhappy. And then it came to pass that Jonah was thrown overboard. And in this great whale's mouth that God prepared for him, he called upon the grace of God. He said, "God, I fault myself. I failed you when I did not do as you. Give me another chance." After 3 days and 3 nights, he wrestled with God. He wrestled, he pleaded for the grace of God. How many of you today is wrestling? How many of you this morning is pleading for the grace of God like Jonah did? And God commanded his fish to spit Jonah out on Nineveh's land. He did not pay a fee. He did not pay anything for food. And he was not food for the way he lied. Spit out on Nineveh land, went down to Nineveh and preached. And in 3 days, God spared the city. Jonah forgot the grace that God extended to him. And say, "God, why did you extend it?" Began to sulk and fret and worry and cry, "God, you're too gracious." And then God had to do some things to let him know that I am God.
Yes.
Friends, today, even though God may rescue us, his grace is evidently in our favor. Why should we discriminate and look down upon those who also need grace? Why can't we listen to that song that says, "Rescue the perishing, and care for the dying, and snatch them in pity from sin and the grave, weep over the erring one, pick up the fallen and tell them what Jesus the mighty has said." I leave you with the song, "Amazing Grace," John Newton, my cousin. My God, he was a slave owner. He ran slaves, he was a drunkard. Then he carried slaves across the Atlantic of Airbus. When my God one day, God took to him, this grace of God that appears for a man, appeared to John Wooden. A man that appeared to him, he was so overwhelmed by what God was doing. He came to the conclusion that this was not only grace, but this was an amazing grace. Amazing grace. sadness into gladness, that praise and joy, over sadness into joy, or despair into hope. Is this grace of God today that I point you to?
Yes.
Is the grace of God.
Yes.
Before John 3:16, and the grace of God after John 3:16 that brings salvation to man.
Yes.
This morning, do you know Jesus tonight, this morning, for your sake, as your Savior and Lord? Do you know him beyond a shadow of a doubt? Can you say that if you want to be called away by the rude and sickly hands of death, that you will go to heaven? Can you say that today, beyond a doubt? Can you say it? How wonderful.